Hello everybody, I'm Dr. Sneha and welcome to the Perio Hub. So Perio Hub is a YouTube channel where we discuss periodontology related topics, and if that's something interests you, please subscribe to this channel and tap the bell icon. So having said that, let's quickly dive into the present video where we'll be discussing about the dental plaque formation. So we've spoken about Lo et al. And his classical study on the experimental model of gingivitis. And through this experiment, it was seen that how dental plaque is so important for the initiation and progression of gingivitis. So now let's break down the steps of plaque formation into three major categories. So firstly, we have the formation of the pellicle on the tooth surface. Following that, we have the initial adhesion and the attachment of the bacteria onto the pellicle, followed by the colonization and plaque maturation. So let's quickly take an example to understand these steps better. For example, a new locality is being developed. So initially, the infrastructure of the locality is built up. So the roads are constructed, the landscaping procedure is done, gardens are built. So this is something which is similar to the pellicle formation on the tooth surface. Now, once that is done, people start moving into the locality, and initially maybe they don't want to buy a house. So they just rent a flat in that area. So that is similar to the initial adhesion of the bacteria, which is reversible in nature. Now, once people start liking that particular locality, they would go ahead and buy a house for themselves. So that is similar to the attachment of the bacteria onto the surface, which is permanent in nature. Now, once they have settled down in the particular locality, they will start a family, they will have kids, and they will become friends with their neighbors, form organizations. So this comes under the colonization and maturation of the plaque. So now that these steps are clear, let's get into the details. So the first step is the formation of the pellicle. So if this is the tooth surface, an acquired pellicle, also called as the salivary pellicle, is formed within few minutes of brushing our teeth. Now this salivary pellicle then undergoes maturation within few hours to form the mature salivary pellicle. Now, the fundamental agents which are present in the salivary pellicle are the peptides, glycoproteins, keratins, mucins, and proline-rich proteins, which basically come from saliva. But certain bacterial products also contribute to the acquired pellicle formation. Now, if we observe this pellicle under an electron microscope, then we see two layers. The first layer is a thin layer, and it is difficult to remove. So with any kind of mechanical or harsh chemicals, it is difficult to remove this particular thin layer. Following it, we have a thicker layer also called as the globular layer, which is easily detached from the surface. So the primary function of the acquired pellicle is that it protects the tooth surface. It also forms binding sites for the bacterial binding. And the third important function of the acquired pellicle is that it provides nutrition to the bacteria. So it also has certain protein enzymatic activities like peroxidases, lysozymes, and alpha amylases, which affects the metabolism of the bacteria. Now coming on to the second step, which is the initial adhesion and the attachment of the bacteria. So this step is further broken down into three categories. So first we have the transport of the bacteria to the surface. Then we have the initial adhesion, which is reversible in nature, followed by strong attachment, which is irreversible in nature. So first coming on to the transport. Now to reach the locality, we can walk to the place. So that is similar to chemotaxis, or the active movement of the bacteria towards a chemical stimuli. We can swim to the place. Obviously, that's technically not possible, but we need to remember that oral cavity is a fluid environment. So the bacteria can swim through liquid flow with the help of its flagella or pili. And the third type of motion is called as the Brownian movement, wherein it is a random movement of the bacteria in the liquid medium. So the bacteria collides with certain particles in the liquid and moves randomly towards the substrate. So once the transport has occurred, the next step is the initial adhesion of the bacteria. Now this takes place via three major theories. So the first theory or the model is the surface thermodynamic model, wherein it talks about an energy called as the interfacial free energy. So without diving deep into physics, interfacial free energy is nothing but the energy that a surface possesses. So if this energy is negative in nature, then there is attraction of the bacteria which takes place onto the surface. But on the other hand, if this energy is positive, then the bacteria repulsion will take place. The second theory is the DLVO theory, based upon the scientists who have discovered this theory. And this theory is based on the Gibbs free energy, which is a summation of van der Waal attractive forces and the electrostatic repulsive forces. So according to this theory, if the van der Waal forces of attraction exceeds the electrostatic forces of repulsion, then the bacteria gets attracted onto the substrate. And if the electrostatic forces of repulsion is more, then the bacteria does not undergo adhesion. The third theory that we talk is the harmonic oscillator model. Now this is based upon the energy which is produced by the tethering coupling of the bacterial appendages. So the bacteria consists of flagella and pili, which are the bacterial appendages, and when they move, there is certain energy which is formed. Now if this energy pierces the potential energy barrier of the surface, then there is attraction of the bacteria which takes place onto the surface. So based upon these three theories, the bacterial adhesion onto the surface takes place. So the next step after the reversible adhesion is the strong attachment of the bacteria which takes place, and this is facilitated by certain receptors which are present on the acquired pellicle. So these receptors are glycoprotein, protein or polysaccharide in nature, and they are of different types, and they get attached to the corresponding adhesins which are present on the organism. Now for example, the GP340, which is a glycoprotein receptor present on the acquired pellicle, gets attached to the adhesin which is SRAP adhesin on the staph aureus. So that is how the firm attachment takes place. So certain organisms with pili and fimbriae will have tip adhesins, which then get attached to the receptors, which can be glycolipid or glycoprotein. And in certain cases where the bacteria does not possess these appendages, the cell wall itself has certain adhesins, which then gets attached to the receptors, which can be again glycoprotein or glycan in nature. Now once the bacteria has strongly attached to the surface, it starts building up. That is, there is growth and development that occurs, which comes under the process of colonization and maturation of the plaque. So approximately 2 days of undisturbed plaque accumulation, we see that the tooth surface is covered by the acquired pellicle, followed by the attachment of these bacteria. So these bacteria are also called as the primary colonizers or pioneer bacteria, as they get attached directly to the tooth surface. Now these bacteria then secrete certain extracellular slime layer, which helps to protect the bacteria itself, as well as helps in the attraction of other genetically different bacteria onto the surface. Now this kind of attachment takes place via two mechanisms. So one is called as co-adhesion, and second is termed as co-aggregation. So co-adhesion is nothing but the interaction between the bacteria which is attached to the salivary pellicle and the bacteria which is suspended in a fluid medium or a planktonic bacteria. So here one bacteria is attached and the other bacteria is free flowing in the liquid. Now the second type of attachment is termed as co-aggregation, wherein it is seen that both the bacteria here are suspended. So both the bacteria are planktonic bacteria, which then interacts and forms co-aggregates. Now there are various types of co-aggregates which are seen. For example, we have something called as the corncob appearance, wherein a central filamentous bacteria such as a cornibacterium or actinomycetes interacts with other gram-positive cocci to give rise to a corncob appearance. The second type is the test tube brush appearance, wherein a central filamentous microorganism interacts with short rod-like species, giving rise to a test tube brush appearance. And we have the rosette appearance, wherein a cocci interacts with other cocci cells to form a flower-like appearance or a rosette appearance. So because of co-adhesion and co-aggregation, the bacterial growth takes place and it also interacts with genetically different species of bacteria to form micro colonies. So if we see an undisturbed plaque sample, say after a week, then it is seen that there are early colonizers or the primary colonizers getting attached to the tooth or the salivary pellicle directly, followed by presence of late colonizers or secondary colonizers, which then get attached to the primary colonizers. So there is a shift in the type of bacteria which is seen. So primary colonizers are usually gram-positive aerobic bacteria, whereas the secondary colonizers are gram-negative anaerobic bacteria, which are seen. Again, let's look at this picture wherein this is the tooth structure, and the primary colonizers, which are usually gram-positive cocci and rods, are attached directly to the salivary pellicle. But as the time progresses, there is a shift in the microbiota which is seen, and here the bacteria mainly seen towards the epithelium or away from the tooth surface are the gram-negative rods and the spirochetes. So the whole concept of periodontal microbiology or periopathogens is very huge, and it will be covered later on. But for now, just understand that there are primary colonizers getting attached to the tooth surface or salivary pellicle directly, followed by the secondary colonizers, which are mostly anaerobic in nature, then getting attached to the primary colonizers via receptors. So here we see a mature plaque sample wherein very specifically we see micro colonies of bacteria, which are genetically very distinct from each other. We can see the extracellular slimy layer, which is secreted by the bacteria to protect itself from the harsh oral environment and also from antibiotics and other host immune agents. And also we see these fluid channels, which help in the oxygen and nourishment flow, and also carry the bacterial waste products away. So to quickly recapitulate what we saw in the present video, we spoke about the steps of dental plaque formation. We spoke about the formation of the acquired pellicle, which is formed on a clean tooth surface, and it is a very important step for further bacterial adhesion and attachment to take place. And once the bacteria is attached, it grows and interacts with other genetically distinct species of bacteria to form colonization and plaque maturation. So I hope this video was helpful and useful, and if it was, please hit the like button. This helps the video get discovered better by other viewers. And until we meet next, take good care of yourself. This is PerioHub signing off.